welcome. We're glad you're with us this morning. Thank you so much for taking time to worship God with us. We are down a little bit on Father's Day, which is a little bit typical, but fathers, we thank you for being here with us today, especially those fathers who have a spiritual interest. That's who we're looking for. Now, this afternoon, we will have our afternoon 2 p.m. small Bible studies, and we may begin singing at about 1:30, so be sure and join us for that. Something's happening around here. Vacation Bible School is about to begin. When 2 weeks from today, we will be beginning our Vacation Bible School. So let's look forward to that and be sure you're extending those invitations to all the children that you get, that you have in your influence. If you will, won't you stand with me as we begin our worship today? DJ will be preaching for us in just a few minutes. There is beyond the azure blue, a brother still from your side. He did it with heavenly hue, and bring the worlds with his great mind. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live, and we survive. From the start, God, creating man, he is our God.
Pray with me, please. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful day. We thank you for the sunshine. Thank you for the cool breeze. We just ask that you continue to bless us as you always do. Help us as your children to know what today is all about. It's okay for us to serve our and worship our fathers here on earth. But help us to remember that you in heaven are much more important than even our fathers were. Help us to understand that our real hero is Jesus. He gave his life that we could live with you someday. And we just ask that you help us continue to take that to the world. Help us continue to tell people about Jesus and what he can do for your life, what he can do for our lives. We thank you for uplifting those that have been sick and that are feeling better. We thank you for taking care of some of the ones that have fallen and hurt themselves. And we just ask you to continue to watch over them. Help us to help as much as we can. Help us always to do your will, and especially today as we study more about you and as we praise you in song. Thank you for giving us this chance to talk to you in prayer. Thank you for everything. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is from John 14, verses 23 and 24. Jesus answered and said to him, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me."
What will it be like when my pain is gone and the worries of this world just fade away? What will it be like when you call my name in that moment when I see you face to face? I'm waiting my whole life to hear you say, "Well done, my good and faithful one.
You know, when Jesus was instituting this memorial, he said, when you do this, do it in remembrance of me. So what do we want to remember? Well, clearly we would remember the suffering. Suffering in the garden. He told his disciples, my soul's become deeply grieved to the point of death. Sweat became like drops of blood falling down upon the ground. The beating he took, the scourging, and of course the crucifixion. I can't comprehend. It's not just death, but torture. I can't comprehend the pain. Then of course there's becoming the scapegoat for us, of God putting sin upon him. So as we partake this morning, I want us to make it personal. I would ask that you think about what Jesus has done specifically for you. Think about your sin. Maybe over your life, over the last year, last week, whatever works for you. What evil things have you done? What dirty thoughts have you had that Jesus had to take on the cross? Specifically for you, and make it
make it personal. As we participate in this memorial, let's pray. Father, thank you so much for that sacrifice of Jesus that allows us to draw near to you. Father, as we take this bread, help us to think about the body of Jesus, about the suffering, what Jesus did for us. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. As we partake of the cup, let's remember the blood. That blood that is so, so significant for us. The blood of the very Lamb of God, the pure, undefiled Jesus, shed for us. Think about, we might think about where the blood is coming from. It's coming from his head, from his crown of thorns, shoulders and back, from his scourging, the side of the nails, the crucifixion, after his death from his side where he's pierced. There's a lot of blood flowing. Precious blood. Let's pray. Father, thank you for the blood that was shed, for its power of redemption. Father, as we partake of this cup, may we remember the blood and its significance, its power, what great news it is for us. In Jesus' name, amen. This concludes our observance of that memorial. We will take up a collection at this time. May we indeed be cheerful givers. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for blessing us materially. Father, may we give back as you've commanded us to do. May we do so with cheerful hearts as we've been prospered. May we also give of our time and our talents. In Jesus' name, amen.
This time, we'll encourage the children to give thanks to Christ and go on to Bible times. We're going to stay seated and watch the children go today, shall we? And this is a song we all need to remember. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts, and the letter to the Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians and Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, Titus and Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st and 2nd and 3rd John, Jude and Revelation. VBS is coming soon. Will you stand with me as we sing the song for our lesson this morning? There is a name I love to hear, I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear, the sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first
Hi, good morning. I feel like I need to introduce myself because we haven't been here for quite a while. I'm DJ Stucky, the associate minister here at the West Freeway Church of Christ. Dana and I have been gone the last 2 weeks at Bible camp, and we've had a wonderful, wonderful time. But I tell you, that first night of sleep back from camp in your own bed, there is nothing like it. We are very, very glad to be home and to be with you. To be with you all this morning. And also, I'd be remiss if I didn't say Happy Father's Day to all of our fathers who are here. We are grateful that you are here with your family, worshiping God this morning. And as fathers, one of the things that we are concerned with is teaching our children the value of obedience. And it's not just because we want them to listen to us, it's because when they learn obedience to their earthly fathers, we want them to understand the importance of obeying their heavenly father. Amen. And so today, we're going to look at this idea of deeper obedience? What can we do to strengthen our obedience to God? You know, obedience is something that we learn at a very young age, right? We learn to obey our parents, because if we don't, there's consequences associated with that. And then as we get older, we kind of figure out, okay, I guess mom and dad kind of knew what they were talking about. We obey our teachers. We obey the law. We understand that obedience is important, right? But obedience isn't always looked on favorably, especially in the United States, because one of the things that we value above all else is that we value our independence. We value our individuality. And in our culture, we've kind of romanticized the idea of rebelling against authority, right? If you look at Star Wars, one of the most popular science fiction franchises in the world, you have the Galactic Empire and what? The Rebellion. Our nation itself, the American Revolution, was a war of rebellion against authority. Our nation was built on rebellion. And so we kind of romanticize this idea of rebelling against the law, rebelling against the rules. But brethren, obedience and submission to that law, that's part of being a Christian. In fact, if you are a Christian, you've already obeyed to some extent. You have put on Christ in baptism and have made that commitment to Him. You've already obeyed, but how can we take our obedience deeper? And so this morning I want to look at the different motivations that we might have for our obedience and to see how we can take those motivations deeper and deeper, and then we'll end with some practical suggestions for how we can take our obedience deeper. So number one, deeper obedience has the right motivation. And the first, I guess, layer of obedience, right? If we're talking about obedience having depth, well, let's start at the surface level. I say that the first layer is that I obey because it's familiar. I obey because it's familiar. Now, this may not apply to everyone here, but I look out and I know that there are many in the audience this morning who grew up in Christian homes. You were taught the Bible from a young age, and the church has always been a part of your life, right? You learned all of the Bible stories when you were little. You probably learned that song we sang for Coins for Christ. You probably learned that song when you were 2 or 3 years old, right? You attended Bible classes from a young age, and your parents made sure that you got involved with church activities, right? And that is a blessing. But, you know, when we are young, much of our involvement in spiritual things is because of our parents. They are instilling in us a habit of being involved in spiritual things and thinking about the things of God. But as we get older, we can continue to do these things not because I feel passionate about them, but because they are comfortable. I continue to obey because it's familiar. This is what I've always known. So why would I take the effort to go and change and do something else? But if that's the only reason I obey, because this is what I've always known, we are in real danger of lacking the type of commitment that God would have us to show. In Matthew chapter 13, 47 through 50, we have the parable of the dragnet. And Jesus says, "The kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore, and they sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but they threw the bad away. So it will be at the end of the age, the angels will come forth, separate the wicked from among the just, and cast them into the furnace of fire. There will be wailing and gnashing of teeth." Right? So in this example, Jesus is describing fishermen who would go out, and they would take a net between two different boats, and they would sail along the lake, and as they were going, they are not just catching the fish that they want to catch to sell and make a profit. Everything that is in the way of that net, good, bad, or otherwise, is going to be captured, right? The good fish were there, but the less desirable fish were there too. They were in the same place, and both of them were in the right place. Okay, remember, in this illustration, The dragnet is the kingdom of God. It is the church. It is obeying the gospel and being in the right place. And brethren, there are going to be people who are in the right place, but they have not given their hearts to God. Right? When we think about the bad fish, they were there in the net with the good fish simply because they were in the same place. Right? They were swimming nearby, and it was easier to stay there than to change direction and get out of the way of the net. Sometimes we end up doing the right thing because everyone around us is encouraging us to do the right thing. They are expecting us to do the right thing. Right? We could have grown up in the church and all of our friends are in the church and we continue being involved in the church because, well, that's where my friends are. I don't want to disappoint my friends. I want to be there with them. This is what I know. And brethren, most people don't like big changes. In fact, most people hate big changes, right? It's something that makes us uncomfortable. And it is easier to keep doing the things we've always done. And now, there is safety and security in doing those things that I am familiar with. And when I am familiar with doing the right thing, and that is my default state, that is a good thing, right? When I'm looking at these motivations, none of these are bad motivations. But they can be incomplete, right? I can obey because it's familiar, but I may lack conviction in my beliefs or understanding of why they are so important, right? So that's our first layer. I obey because I've always done it, right? This is how I grew up. This is what's familiar to me. But number two, I can obey to avoid punishment. Now, this is probably the most basic motivation for obedience. Right? As a kid, you learn pretty quickly that when you disobey mom and dad, bad things happen. Whether that's a timeout, whether that's getting a spanking, whether as an older kid that was losing TV privileges or not being allowed to go and spend time with your friends or having the car keys taken away, whatever it was, we follow the rules because we don't want to be punished for breaking them. Right, we obey that 70 mile an hour speed limit sign because we don't want to get pulled over and have to pay a big speeding ticket. And for many people, the desire to avoid punishment is the first step in obeying God. Because we learn that God has created a set of rules to follow. And He has revealed those rules to us in the pages of Scripture. And so if we recognize, well, I'm going to be judged by God's rules at the end of time, well, there are some punishments that are associated with it if I choose not to follow the rules. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 10 to the first part of verse 11, it says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each may receive the things done in the body according to what he has done, whether good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. When I recognize that there is a God who is above all things and that he has given a law to me that I am responsible for obeying, that should put a little bit of fear in me. Amen. That if I don't do things the way God says, there's a good path and there is a bad pathway, and those are the only two options. I am either going to be judged righteous and enter into heaven with God, or I'm going to be judged unrighteous and cast away from God to be punished eternally. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 7 through 9, it says, to give you who are troubled rest with us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on those who do not know God, and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. These shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Now, in this passage, when it talks about us being punished from the presence of the Lord, that idea is that we are going to be away from the presence of the Lord, and we are going to be punished away from the glory of his power. You know, in this life, when we are stressed, when we're in trouble, we can pray to the Lord and ask for his help and ask for guidance. But we're not going to have that in hell. In hell, we are away from the presence of God. See, God is everywhere. He is all-powerful. He is all-present. But he will not be in hell. We are separated from him. And that's what makes it so terrible. You know, when we think about the things that we love most in this world, every good thing that we have, our friends, our family, the feeling of love and belonging, none of those things will be there in hell because all good things originate from God. Amen. James chapter 1, verse 17 says, every good and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow cast of turning. See, hell is a place where no good things are. The gospel accounts, like we just read, describe hell as a place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And when we think about, well, that's not a place I want to be, so I better follow the rules. Right? In the Revelation, John is given a vision of what the judgment will be like. And he describes it this way, starting in Revelation 20 and verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. The way that God has seen fit to describe the suffering that hell will be, an existence without him, separated from him, was a lake of fire. And so when I discover what hell is, and I understand the punishment, I know I don't want to be there. And when I discover that God has sent his son to pay the penalty on my behalf, I'll accept that sacrifice and obey God so I don't have to face his wrath. Amen. And that is where many of us begin our journey of obedience to God. And that is not a bad thing. In Proverbs chapter 9 and verse 10, it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Right? I may obey because it's familiar and because of what I've always known. But if it's not familiar to me, when I learn that there is punishment associated with my disobedience, I'll decide to get my life right. Right? I can obey to avoid punishment. Thirdly, I may obey to please others. There are some who obey because they want to please their parents. They want to please their elders. They don't want to disappoint their friends that they have. Obedience is expected and encouraged. And so we don't want to disappoint anyone. And so, well, to make others happy, I am going to strive to do the right thing. Now, my mom and dad are here, and they may correct me on this, but when I was a kid, I don't remember them having to punish me a lot. And it wasn't because I didn't disobey, right? It wasn't because I didn't break the rules, but all they had to do was give me the withering look and say that they were disappointed in me, and I would just melt into a puddle. Like, I was done for, right? And it was because the worst thing was knowing that my parents were disappointed. I wanted to make them happy. I wanted to please them. And so, this is an example of what I like to call positive peer pressure. When others around me are encouraging me to obey, and I don't want to let them down, and they are encouraging me to do right things, that is positive peer pressure, right? Wanting to fit in with others who are also being obedient. But there can be a negative side to this too. Right? Jesus talks about the Pharisees who made a show of their obedience because they wanted the praise of men. In Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 and 6, Jesus says, "When you pray, you will not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the corners of the streets that they may be seen by men. Assuredly, I say to you, they have their reward. But you, when you pray, go into your room, and when you have shut your door, pray to your Father who is in the secret place, and the Father who sees in secret will reward you openly." Now, the Pharisees were doing good things. They were praying. They were giving. They were fasting. They were reading Scripture. And they were certainly Pharisees who were doing all of these things because they genuinely desired to be godly people and have a stronger relationship with their Heavenly Father. But there were some of them who obeyed simply because it increased their reputation. There were those of them who obeyed because they wanted people to look at them as these great spiritual people. But that can't be our only motivation. You know, I know there are some who have been involved with Lads to Leaders or Leadership Training for Christ, and in those organizations, there are competitions for different things like song leading or preaching, or there's Bible quizzes and other things, and those are all good, right? Where we are trying to encourage our young people to learn more, and we're using that healthy competition to help them to push their limits. And healthy competition is really good. When I was a student in preaching school, I managed to get all A's in my classes, not necessarily because of me, but I had a friend named Callie Puckett, who was in my class, who was also good at academics, and we would always see who could get the better grade on our tests. Right? And that little bit of healthy competition drove us to do better. In Proverbs 27:17, it says, "As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another." But if my only reason for reading my Bible is because I want to win a competition, or because I want to make the elders happy because they've given a Bible reading program, or I want to impress my friends, then my obedience is incomplete. It's obedience, it's doing good things, but I'm doing it so people can recognize me. Now, obedience motivated by a desire to avoid punishment, or obedience motivated by positive peer pressure or pressure from a good environment, none of those things are bad. Okay? All of those things are good things, but they are incomplete motivations. If we are only motivated by these three things, we'll never become the mature, fully grown Christians that God desires us to be. So let's take it a layer further. Number four, I obey to please God. And this is where we start getting into genuine, heartfelt obedience, because I am now obeying not because of how it can benefit me, but now I obey because I recognize that everything that I have has been given to me by God, and I want to make Him happy. In John 14 and verse 15, it says simply, "If you love me, keep my commandments." You know, we are much more likely to listen to the people that we love than we are to those that we care nothing about. You know, when my wife asks me to do something around the house and to help her, it takes effort, right? But I do it because I love my wife. I don't do it because I have to listen to her. I listen to her because I love her and I want to please her. That's how our relationship with God needs to be. That I don't listen to Him just because I'm afraid or just because I feel obligated, but because I love my God. Amen. And I want to do those things that please Him. In 1 John chapter 4 and verse 17, It says, love has been perfected or made complete among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment. But he who fears has not been made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. See, perfect, complete, mature love isn't motivated only by fear. Complete love, complete obedience, is motivated by love itself. Again, fear is not inherently bad. In Ecclesiastes 12:13, it says, fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. I have to honor God. I have to respect God and recognize the power that he has over me. But I don't have to live in fear of punishment from God. Because when I get to the point where I am obeying because I love God and I recognize the love that God has for me, I will know that God doesn't want to punish me. In fact, everything that God has done from the beginning of time until this day was so that you could be in heaven with him for eternity. Amen. See, God's greatest gift was sending Jesus Christ to pay the price for our sin so we don't have to fear punishment. God wants a relationship with you. And when we belong to God, we don't have to live in fear of punishment. Amen. Now, we fear God in the sense that we honor him and we respect him and we understand the completeness of his power over my life. But we do not live in fear as if God is just waiting for us to mess up so he can punish us. Now, I think some people get this image of God as if he's sitting up in heaven and he's got all of these monitors looking at our lives and he's just waiting for us to screw up so he can hit the button that says, all right, DJ, straight to hell. That is not how God works. Everything God has done has been so that I can be with him. God wants a relationship with me. You know, at camp this last week, a brother named Kevin Rutherford was doing the classes for the kids. And one of the things that he did every day is he had us repeat this. He said, you are important. God loves you. And to God be the glory. Amen. God loves you. You are important enough for God to send his son to die for you. And when we recognize that great love that God has for us, we will want to obey to please him. In 1 John 5 and verse 3, it says, this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. When we weigh out everything that God has done for us, and we measure that against the responsibilities that he requires, it's nothing. It's nothing. His commandments are not burdensome. God is not asking us to do more than we are able. And so when I am obeying, I allow the motivation of that obedience to be pleasing him because of everything he's done for me. And then fifthly, and you sort of follow me here, because after everything I've said, this point is going to sound a little bit weird, but I obey because it pleases me. Follow with me here. I don't do this in a selfish way. I don't obey because of all of the benefits it brings to me, but when I'm obeying because it pleases me, it's because I have made God's will my own. You know, Christianity is a process of becoming more and more like Jesus every day. In Ephesians 5 and verse 1, Paul says, be imitators of God as dear children. We are becoming more like God. And for Jesus, he would say in John 4 and verse 34, said, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. The thing that pleased Jesus the most in this world, the thing that sustained him, was doing the will of God. It pleased Jesus to do God's will. And so it should please me to do God's will. You know, Christianity not only affects what you do and where you go, but it should change how you think. And as you grow in your service to God and you please Him, doing godly things will become more and more satisfying to you. Doing righteous things will bring you the most joy and pleasure in life. But that's a process. We have to start by doing the right things, and eventually doing the right things will become pleasurable. You know, before I came and tried out at West Freeway, I was about 20, 25 pounds heavier than I was. When I first started exercising, I did not like it. It was hard. It wasn't really that fun. But the more I did it, the more I began to enjoy the process of exercise. And it's getting to the point now where I'm beginning to enjoy the workout, not because of all the benefits it brings, but to enjoy it for its own sake. Well, that's the way our obedience to God should be. Is I'm not thinking about all of these other things and responsibilities. It's that I feel best and I am happiest when I am doing the things that God wants me to do. We should strive to get down to these last two layers of obedience, where I am obeying because I know God loves me and I want to show my love for Him. And then I have done that so much that doing the right things brings me joy. So, let's end with a few practical applications, some practical suggestions, and then the lesson will be yours. So how do I deepen my obedience? Number one, make a commitment to spiritual growth. Make spiritual growth and being more knowledgeable of God and more like God in the things that you do, make that a priority in your life. And Hebrews chapter 5, beginning in verse 12, the writer says this. It says, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the first principles of the oracles of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. For everyone who partakes only of milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. But solid food belongs to those who are of full age, that is, those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. See, brethren, the more that we know about God and His character and His actions and His commandments, the more like Him we can become. But we can't imitate God if we don't know anything about Him. As Christians, we are expected to grow. Right? Notice the Hebrews writer says, you ought to be teachers by this time. There was an expectation that they would grow in their knowledge and grow in their ability to serve. And then he brings out this idea that, hey, everyone, a baby needs milk. They can't handle solid food. But if you have a 13-year-old who's still on a diet of milk, that's going to be a problem, isn't it? If we aren't growing, then we are dying. You look at anything in this world. You look at plants, you look at animals, you look at human beings. If we are not growing, then we are in the process of dying. Brethren, we can never decide that our current level of knowledge or current level of spiritual maturity is enough. Being a Christian means that I'm committing to a lifetime of spiritual growth. It's a recognition that I am never going to have arrived. I'm never going to be there where I can sit back on my laurels and say, I've done enough. Because even Paul, the apostle, recognized that he needed to press forward towards God. In Philippians 3, 12 through 14, he says, not that I have already attained or I'm already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Right? Even Paul the Apostle, who did so many incredible things for God's kingdom, at the end of his life, he said, hey, I'm not there yet, but I'm going to keep pushing forward. I'm going to keep growing stronger in the faith. And brethren, that's something that all of us should strive for. So make a commitment to spiritual growth and your obedience to God will deepen. Secondly, develop and maintain relationships with spiritual people. You know, we looked at in our motivations for obedience is that I obey because it's familiar and that my environment makes it easy. Well, brethren, having an environment that helps you obey is not a bad thing. Being around other Christians who are doing the right things, being around other spiritually minded people who are trying to grow is only going to make it that much easier for you to grow yourself. It is going to be so much easier to grow when you can do it together, right? When you have other people who are holding you accountable for being spiritual. So if you want to have deeper obedience, I encourage you, find relationships and develop relationships with people in the church who are already doing it well. I guarantee you, you'll see success yourself. And thirdly, make time for prayer and study. You know, we develop any good relationship through communication. Well, today, God is speaking to us through His Word. It says in 2 Timothy 3 and verse 16, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. And then 2 Timothy 2:15 says, to be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The point being, God speaks to us through the things that are written in His Word. The idea that Scripture is given by inspiration is that it is breathed out by God. The things that God wants us to know, He has committed to faithful men who wrote them down so that we know what God wants. God has communicated to us. But you know, when someone's talking to you, it's really rude to ignore them, isn't it? God is speaking to us through His Word. And so we need to take the time to look at His Word and to study it, to know what God is saying. But you know, if I'm just sitting and listening, that's not really a conversation, is it? The way that we communicate to God is through prayer. We lay our cares and concerns before Him in prayer. And we will grow closer to Him as we pray and we give more and more of our cares and concerns over to God, and we share more of our struggles and our joy with God, the closer we're going to become to Him. It's just like any other relationship we have in this life. It requires that two-way communication. And so I encourage you, work Bible reading into your routine, whether that's in the morning or before bed or right after dinner or during your lunch break at work, whatever it is, make time to hear what God has to say to you. And then make time to communicate back to Him in prayer. If you make time for prayer and study, then you will grow closer to God and your obedience will be deeper. So, brethren, obedience is a necessary part of being a child of God. And there can be layers to our obedience, and we want to be like that iceberg where that obedience runs deep. So don't obey just because it's easy and familiar. Don't obey only because you want to make others proud and to have good relationships. Don't obey only because you fear punishment. Obey because you want to please God. And as you please God, obey, because doing righteous things satisfies you. This morning, if you are here and you have not yet obeyed God in putting on Christ in baptism, then we can help you. To make that commitment to say, I am going to be God's child, and I am going to follow Him and obey Him until the end. We can be there to help you with that this morning, to immerse you in water for the forgiveness of your sins, and you can become a child of God. For the rest of us, I hope this has been an encouragement and a reminder that we can do better on our obedience, and that we can be higher in our commitment deepen our obedience, and be more of the people that God would have us to be. This morning, if you are subject to the invitation, won't you come while together we stand and while we sing?
Out of my heart in sorrow and night, Jesus, I come, Jesus, I come, into thy freedom, gladness, and light, Jesus, I come.
Someone corrected one of my notes up here. They did kind of like a redneck scribbled it out. I love it. Glad you're here today. We're here today because we love God. Because we're very thankful for Him and Jesus. You know, today we honor fathers, and sometimes if we look back at our life, we can get down because we're thinking, I wasn't the perfect father. Well, I'm sorry to tell you, there is no perfect father except God.
Amen.
So don't be down on yourself. If what you're doing is not right right now, then change. That's the best I can do is tell you, if what you're doing right now ain't getting it done, then change.
Amen.
Change what you're doing.
Amen.
If it's already past, all your kids are grown, change still what you're doing. Because it's never too late to be a good daddy. And God, all He wants out of us, all He's ever asked, is our best.
Amen.
We are having small groups today, so make sure you know that. The other announcements I'm not going to announce. But let you know that I love you. I'm glad you're here. Where else could we be? And then the world says, well, I could be at the sports game. I could be out playing all kinds. I could be fishing. I could be skiing. I could be enjoying the sun. Who gave us the sun? Who gave us the water? Who gave us the ability to play, have a good time? Let's keep everything in perspective. Keep it the way it ought to be. Because many times we're told, seek ye first kingdom of God and its righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Pray with me, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we humble ourselves for you now, anoint you of God. We know that that we're not perfect. Help us always to do our best to make you proud in how we act and how we speak, how we treat others. Help us always look to do better. Forgive us when we don't, and help us stand up stronger next time. We have so many that have lost loved ones. We pray that you touch their heart and ease their pain, and help them to know that all they got to do is keep pressing on. Be with the ones that are fighting physical things, John, fighting the seizures and everything and things in his life. Be with him. Give him your power and strengthen him that he can do his best and always be thankful. Dear Father, thank you for everybody that's here, everybody that's watching, everybody that wanted to be here but couldn't. Bless them and bless their lives, that they always seek you and that they always choose you, because every second it is a choice. Thank you, God, for all that you are, for all that you've done, for all that you're going to do. Thank you, God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
You're dismissed.